Broadside Books and Harper Audio present No Trade is Free, Changing Course, Taking on China, and Helping America's Workers by Robert Lighthizer. Read by Charles Constant. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/pages/no-trade-is-free. It contains charts and notes and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. To Bob and Claire, and to every American worker who makes our country great. When the facts change, I change my mind. What do you do, sir? Attributed to John Maynard Keynes. Failure is not fatal, but failure to change might be. John Wooden. Introduction. In Washington, D.C., it was an overcast day on June 9, 2010, and, by local standards, on the cool side. 70 degrees is a comfortable temperature there in the summer. I was in a taxi on my way to the Dirksen Senate Office Building to testify before the U.S.-China Economic and Security Review Commission. This was a group of 12 men and women appointed by the bipartisan congressional leadership and tasked with assessing U.S. relations with China. By the time my panel began, the temperature had risen a bit and it had started to rain. I thought, perfect. Depressing report on a depressing day. I was appearing on a panel with a couple other trade law experts. A group from Congress, including Senators Lindsey Graham of South Carolina and Chuck Schumer of New York, was on right before us. My task for the commission was to evaluate the impacts of China's joining the World Trade Organization, WTO, 10 years on. The commission invited me to speak because by that point I was well known in Washington circles as a skeptic, not only of trade relations with China, but also of the international trade system writ large. I had been a trade lawyer for more than 30 years, working for the U.S. Senate, in the Reagan administration, and in private law practice, representing American manufacturers in front of administrative agencies and courts. By the time of the hearings in 2010, I was one of a small handful of Washington commentators willing to openly argue against the negative effects of Washington's one-sided free trade agenda. My testimony on American trade relations with China that day was 35 single-spaced pages. It showed in great detail what a disaster the 2000 decision to grant China Most Favored Nation, MFN, status had been for America, and particularly for our workers. It listed all the commitments that China had made back then and showed how they hadn't kept them, presented the economic calamity that these 10 years had been for us, and highlighted the giddy pronouncements that our politicians had made, including President Clinton, Republican presidential candidate George W. Bush, and many leaders in Congress. The testimony quoted their unparalleled optimism. This was a 100-to-nothing deal, proclaimed then-President Clinton. And then my testimony gave the butcher's bill. We had lost millions of jobs and thousands of factories while wages had stagnated. This ultimate concession to communist leaders, free trade, and multinational corporations had been an unmitigated disaster for working people. Finally, I predicted it was only going to get worse for our workers if we stayed on the same course, and I made specific policy recommendations, including imposing tariffs on Chinese imports, to correct the problem. After the hearing, two of the commissioners told me it was the most important testimony they had heard in their tenure, but little to nothing changed over the following half decade. My warnings over China went largely unheeded, just as though they had throughout the 1990s when I editorialized and fought against allowing China to join the WTO, the ratification of the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, and Washington's radical free trade agenda. Well before 2010, it was clear to me that the issue of American trade relations with China was not an isolated problem, but was instead emblematic of larger issues in U.S. trade policy. The political establishments of both the Republican and Democratic parties, under the influence of multinational corporations and importers, were unwilling or unable to recognize their mistakes. Instead, they remained convinced that rather than protect American workers and manufacturers, government policy had to put them at risk amid a quest to maximize corporate profits and economic efficiency while minimizing consumer prices. The result of this effort today is a starker, more indisputable failure than even I could have predicted. While corporate profits soared for a select group of importers and retailers, many of America's manufacturing companies were hollowed out, forced either into bankruptcy or into moving their factories abroad. And what about ordinary Americans? Though prices for some products declined, wage growth in this country has utterly stagnated since the 1980s, driven in large part by the decline of manufacturing sector employment. As a result, increasingly, working-class families must rely on two full-time incomes in lower-end service sector jobs to maintain the same quality of life one manufacturing sector income once provided. It is no exaggeration to say that American leaders traded the health of the U.S. industrial base and the good-paying manufacturing jobs it supported for current consumption and little more. A look at the specifics emphasizes the problem. We have had 50 straight years of trade deficits with Japan, annual deficits of more than $300 billion with China for years, and enormous and sharply growing deficits with Europe, primarily Germany and Ireland, and a whopping 27% of Vietnam's entire economy is exports to the United States. The first personal computer was rolled out by Apple in 1976, made in America. Today, the vast majority of our personal computers are imported, and those few that are made domestically are assembled largely with imported parts. In 2020, almost $90 billion worth of computers were imported. In 1995, America was the largest producer of solar cells globally, with 45% of world production. Today, virtually no solar cells are made in America, and 78% of world production is in China. From the 1960s through the 1980s, the United States was the lead source of rare earth materials, largely from Mountain Pass Mine in California. Today, because of Chinese industrial policy, the United States accounts for just 12% of global production, while China accounts for 62%. North Carolina had a vibrant furniture manufacturing sector with 90,000 middle-class jobs. Within 10 years of China joining the WTO, imports flooded our markets, and half the workforce lost their jobs. Now, 73% of all furniture sold in America is imported. In 1990, the United States imported about $40 billion worth of cars. That number exploded to more than $180 billion by 2020, and for the first time in our history, less than half the cars sold in America may be assembled here. In the 1970s and 1980s, the United States was the world's leading producer of critical semiconductors. Today, we manufacture only 12% of global supply, and we cannot make any of the most advanced chips. For the first time in our history, the United States is on track to import more food than we export. Donald Trump was elected president in 2016 in substantial part because he opposed the failed policy that got us such miserable results and promised to change it. He asked me to head up his trade policy and negotiation effort because I had spent my professional life fighting against these same forces. For nearly 40 years, I had litigated, negotiated, and editorialized against the failed policies of hyper-free trade. My philosophy of international trade and the philosophy that undergirds this book is starkly at odds with the radical free trade theology that got us here. Simply put, I believe that American trade policy should revolve around helping working-class American families. Enhancing corporate profits, increasing economic efficiency, and lowering consumer prices are important, but in my view, secondary to this goal. When I look at the world today, the only practical way to help working people I see is to support the American manufacturing sector. We must never forget that international trade, like all economic policy, is beneficial only if it contributes to the well-being of most of our citizens, if it makes families stronger, and if it makes our communities better. These broader goals are the real objective. In this context, it is imperative to remember that our citizens are first producers and only second consumers. Producing things is crucial to citizens' capacity to enjoy the dignity of work, support their families, and actively contribute to society. When all citizens, including those without college degrees, have a chance to be productive, it's good for the country. American trade policy in the 1990s and early 2000s ignored this reality, and its failures are why, when I took over running American trade policy in early 2017, I knew we needed to follow a new trajectory aimed at advancing America's workers. Our success explains why the Biden administration has continued many of the changes in U.S. trade policy that President Trump and I began. The Trump administration had two historic accomplishments in the area of international trade policy. First, we changed the objective. Previous presidents had too often chased big trade deals that made it easier for companies to import products into the United States and that effectively encouraged manufacturing overseas. The decisions of bureaucrats at the WTO, meanwhile, were regarded as sacrosanct. President Trump changed all that. He was committed to bringing manufacturing jobs back to America. He wanted to reduce imports and to increase exports of manufactured goods and agricultural products. He judged success by the creation of new jobs, wage increases, the movement of factories back to America, and the reduction of the trade deficit. With this new objective as our lodestar, we increased tariffs on imports and fought unfair practices. We insisted that our trading partners grant us more market access. Finally, we took on the World Trade Organization and largely stopped its unfair, undemocratic appellate body. The Trump administration's second great contribution was to awaken the country and ultimately the world to the danger of our growing economic dependence on China. China is an adversary of the United States. Regardless of its rhetoric to the contrary, its actions, and increasingly its words as well, show that China views us as a foe. It poses a military, diplomatic, and economic threat. Prior to the Trump administration, China was often portrayed as a friendly partner. This is an illusion. The reality is that it is a mercantilist nation that wants to impose its system on the world. It is opposed to the liberal democratic order and wants to put an end to American hegemony. Trump's policies reversed the trend of economic dependence and the transfer of trillions of dollars to our adversary in the form of trade deficits. This policy was also a success. Leading up to the onset of COVID-19, the trade deficit with China was reduced from the year before in five straight quarters. Dependence on China was declining. Supply chains were shifting away from China to the United States and other countries. The historic Phase One trade agreement with China maintained our tariffs, brought about substantial systemic change there, and created new markets for our products here at home. I have two goals in this book. First, I want to challenge the way you think about trade policy. I want to lay out the reasoning behind my philosophy of trade and the underlying data that support the major course correction we took under the Trump administration. Second, I want to describe what we did in the Trump administration to implement this philosophy. Through doing this, I hope to show you how a more assertive U.S. trade policy aimed at helping U.S. workers can actually work in practice. In the first part of the book, I will explain in detail how I think about international trade. I feel strongly that the course we set for trade policy must rest on a more complete and nuanced understanding of the effects of international trade in the United States and throughout the world than can be captured by the question of how much we pay for televisions and toys. So, throughout the first four chapters, I will explain why I care about trade policy, Chapter 1, my overarching philosophy on international trade, Chapter 2, how this philosophy is a part of the American tradition, Chapter 3, and how the World Trade Organization has failed, Chapter 4. In the second part of the book, I will focus on how the Trump administration pursued a worker-focused trade policy by resetting our economic relationship with China. It has become increasingly clear that China is the United States' major adversary in the world, militarily, diplomatically, and economically. And yet in trade policy, we don't treat them as an adversary. Indeed, we give them most favored nation status. While we criticize Germany for sending billions of euros to Russia for natural gas, some think it is okay for us to send hundreds of billions of dollars to China for televisions and other consumer goods. Indeed, trade is the Achilles heel of our relationship with China, a weakness that has sapped our strength and that continues to distort our actions across a range of different arenas on the world stage. We need to understand the threat we face from China. We must understand its economic policy. This is a country that is fundamentally different from ours in ways that...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.